Good morning. We will continue with the paraphrase of the poem Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard by Thomas Gray. Yesterday we left off at stanza 20. Today we will start from stanza 21, lines 81 to 100. I quote the text first. Their name, their years spelt by the unlettered muse, the place of fame and elegy supply, and many a holy text around she strews that teach the rustic moralist to die. Unquote. Instead of fame and elegy, says the poet, the people buried here have modest tombstones, which display only their names and the dates of their birth and death. These common people were not famous, and no one has written elaborate elegies or funeral verses for them. Still, the very modesty of their tombstones testifies to the nobility and holy nature of their simple lives. As such, they provide an example not so much of how life should be lived, but how its end, that is death, should be approached. The term rustic moralist here is open to interpretation. It may refer to anyone who is in the countryside thinking about the meaning of death, but more likely it refers to the speaker who is himself moralizing, preaching or contemplating about the nature of both life and death. Their name and age may be incorrectly spelt and carved on the tombstones by some illiterate poet of the village, but it supplies the place of long epitaphs and elegies which are carved on the graves of the rich and famous. There are also engraved on their tombs many quotations from the holy scriptures, which teach the humble villager the moral lesson of the vanity of this world, and thus teach him to die with a smiling countenance. Stanza 22, lines 85 to 88. The text is, for who to dumb forgetfulness a prey, thus pleasing anxious, being ever resigned, left the warm precincts of the cheerful day, nor cast one longing, lingering look behind? The speaker reasons that most people faced with the prospect of dying and ultimately being forgotten, cling to life. Note Gray's use of paradox in line 86, where he says, this pleasing anxious being. On the one hand, being or living can be anxious, filled with worries. On the other hand, just being alive, when faced with death, is itself pleasing or pleasant. The speaker is suggesting that even the troubles and worries of life are enjoyable in comparison to death. In this stanza, we get the poet's reflections on human nature. The desire to have a memorial over his grave is quite natural to man, for knowing that he would be the victim of oblivion, in other words, he would be forgotten. None can be found on this earth who did not long for a memorial to save him from dark oblivion. In life, there are both pleasures and anxieties, and none has ever left the bright and happy enclosure of this world without casting a regretful look behind and feeling an intense desire to make his memory immortal. Stanza 23, lines 89 to 92. The text: on some fond breast the parting soul relies, some pious drops the closing eye requires. Even from the tomb the voice of nature cries, even in our ashes live their wonted fires. The poet is trying to say that the dead rely on the living to remember them and to mourn for them. The speaker suggests that this need is so fundamental that even from the grave, the buried dead seem to ask for remembrance. In fact, as line 92 suggests, the dead actually live on in our memories. Every dying man relies on some affectionate friend or the other and thinks that he will continue to cherish his memory after he is dead. At the time of death, every man longs for a few drops of dutiful and affectionate tears. The natural craving for loving remembrance is noticeable even when a man is buried in his tomb. When everything is consigned to dust and ashes, his desires for loving remembrance finds expression in the inscriptions on his tomb. Stanza 24, lines 93 to 96. The text is: for thee, who mindful of the unhonored dead, dost in these lines their artless tale relate. If chance, by lonely contemplation led, some kindred spirit shall inquire thy fate. Unquote. In this stanza, the speaker addresses himself. He reasons that since he himself has been mindful of the dead and has remembered and praised them in this poem, perhaps when he is dead, someone will remember him. This person, he reasons, will necessarily be a kindred spirit, someone who is also a lonely wanderer in the country, meditating on the nature of death. The speaker then goes on to imagine his own death. He envisions this kindred spirit seeing his, that is the speaker's, grave and wondering about his life and death. The poet here addresses himself and says that now he is intent on honoring the obscure villagers who are dead, and so narrates their simple story in these lines. After his death, he himself would be buried in such a humble grave. It is just possible, accidentally, some poet having feelings similar to his own and inspired by a meditative cast of mind may happen to come to his grave and inquire about his fate. Stanza 25, lines 97 to 100. The text goes like this: haply some hoary-headed swain may say, oft have we seen him at the peep of dawn, brushing with hasty steps the dews away, to meet the sun upon the upland lawn. Unquote the text. In the next five stanzas, the speaker imagines how an old farm laborer might remember him after his death. If, the speaker speculates, the kindred spirit sees the speaker's grave and wonders about it, perhaps an old man might offer to describe the speaker. The old man would say that the speaker was often seen wandering about the countryside at dawn. Presumably, He was frequently out all night, as no doubt he has been in this very poem. It is just possible that some white-haired villager might tell him that often with the appearance of the streaks of dawn on the eastern horizon, we have seen him, that is the speaker, hastily making his way on foot, wiping the dews from the grass in order to reach the grassy highland just as the sun is rising in the sky. Stanza 26, lines 101 to 104. There at the foot of yonder, goes the text, nodding beech that wreathes its old fantastic roots so high, his listless length at noontide would he stretch and pour upon the brook some babbles by, ends the text of this stanza. At noon, the old man continues, the speaker would frequently stretch out under an old tree at noontime and stare at a nearby brook. A brook means a small stream of water which is flowing downhill. The villagers may also tell him that at noon beneath the shade of the yonder beech tree, with its branches swaying to and fro in the gentle wind, and its roots forming themselves into a quaint texture, he would lie down with careless ease, fully stretching out his body and gazing thoughtfully upon the waters of the river that makes a murmuring sound as it flows along. Stanza 27, line 105 to 108. Hard by yon wood, now smiling as in scorn, muttering his wayward fancies he would rove, now drooping, woeful wan, like one forlorn, or crazed with care, or crossed in hopeless love. The old man would have observed that the speaker's moods were changeable. Sometimes the speaker would wander about the nearby woods, smiling scornfully and talking to himself. At other times, he would appear depressed. Then again, sometimes he would look as though he were in anguish. Anguish means pain and sorrow over something. Perhaps the old man speculates, the speaker had been crossed in hopeless love. This is, of course, anticipation. Sometimes, close to the yonder wood, he would wander about, muttering his quaint and indistinctly expressed verses, and sometimes smiling as if in scorn. Sometimes, with a pale and pitiable countenance, the sighs of deep dejection. At other times, he would look distracted, as if with cares and anxieties, or as if he were suffering from disappointment and frustration in love. Stanza 28, lines 109 to 112. The text is, one morn I missed him on the accustomed hill, along the heath and near his favorite tree. Another came, nor yet beside the rill, nor up the lawn, nor at the wood was he. The speaker continues to imagine this old man remembering him after his death. The old man would have noticed one morning that the speaker was absent. He was not in any of his favorite spots. Likewise, the old man would remember the speaker did not appear the following day also. the speaker says, the old man would remember him in somewhat this way. One morning we failed to find him out on the hilltop, which he used to frequent. The word rill means hilltop. For the hill he's saying hilltop. And also in the wood or near the beech tree so much loved by him. The next morning and we still failed to find him by the stream. The word rill means stream. Another word for it in the previous stanza was brook. And we still failed to find him by the stream or on the upland lawn or near the wood. These were his favorite haunts, but he was not there the next day also. Stanza 30, line 113. The text is, the next with high dirges due in sad array, slow through the churchyard path we saw him borne. Approach and read, for thou canst read, the lay graved on the stone beneath yon aged thorn. On the third day, however, the old man and his friends would have seen the speaker's body being carried away to the churchyard for burial. The speaker then is imagining himself buried in the very graveyard he once used to wander by. The old man invites this curious passerby or kindred spirit to read the speaker's epitaph. Note the reminder that the old man is uneducated. He cannot read, although the passerby can do so. So the old man says or tells the passerby, the next day we saw him carried away in his coffin slowly. The funeral procession passed through the way which leads to the church. Songs proper to the melancholy occasion were being sung. Approach and read, for you can read while I cannot. The villager is reminding him. The verses engraved on his stone tomb beneath the old hawthorn tree. And now we have reached the epitaph. Lines 117 to 120. It goes somewhat like this. Here rests his head upon the lap of earth, a youth to fortune and to fame unknown. Fair signs frowned not on his humble birth, and melancholy marked him for her own. Let us understand what the word epitaph means. An epitaph are lines which are written usually in memory of somebody who is dead and gone. It also applies to the inscription that is engraved on the tombstone of a dead person. So here, the last three stanzas are in fact the speaker's epitaph. The way in which the speaker imagines his epitaph will read. Through the epitaph, the speaker asks the passerby and us the readers not to remember him as wealthy, famous or brilliantly educated, but as one who has melancholic or deeply thoughtful and sad. Here in the bosom of Mother Earth lies buried a young man who was neither favored by fortune nor by fame. So goes the epitaph. Though he was poor and humble, yet knowledge looked favorably upon him. Melancholy was his chief characteristic. He had a thoughtful bent of mind, natural to poetic temperament. Next stanza, lines 121 to 124. The text is, this is the second stanza of the epitaph. Large was his bounty and his soul sincere. Heaven did a recompense as largely send. He gave to misery all he had, a tear. He gained from heaven. It was all he wished, a friend, unquote. The speaker asks that we remember him for being generous and sincere. His generosity was, in fact, his willingness to mourn for the dead. Because he was so generous, the speaker reasons, heaven gave him a friend, someone who would in turn mourn for him after his death. This friend is unnamed, but we can deduce that it is any kindred spirit, including the reader, or the visitor or the passerby who comes there, who reads the speaker's epitaph and remembers him. He had a large and liberal heart and a sincere soul, and he was rewarded by God adequately for these qualities. He gave to his miserable fellow men all that he possessed, and that is a tear of sympathy and love. And he got that from God, his friendship or blessing, which is all that he desired. The last stanza of the poem, this is the third stanza in the epitaph, the last four lines, lines 125 to 128. The text is, no further seek his merits to disclose, or draw his frailties from their dread abode. There they are like in trembling hope repose, the bosom of his father and his God. The speaker concludes by cautioning the reader not to praise him any further. He also asks that his frailties, his flaws or personal weaknesses should not be considered. Rather, they should be left to the care of God, with whom the speaker now resides. The poem then is an elegy, not only for the common man, but for the speaker himself. Indeed, by the end of the poem, it is evident that the speaker himself wishes to be identified not with the great and famous, but with the common people whom he has praised and with whom he will presumably be buried. Do not attempt any more to find out his good qualities or to discover his weaknesses, for now he lies dead in his dreadful tomb, continues the speaker. There in the bosom of God, who is the affectionate father of us all, both his merits and demerits rest. His merits make him hope for the mercy of God. The demerits make him tremble in fear as he looks forward to the day of judgment when he would be face to face with God, who is his father. With this, we end the paraphrase of the poem. In the next session, we will look at the themes and other analysis of the poem, Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard by Thomas Gray.